Class, we'll be looking into the concepts of operators. These are all the various operators that are available in Python. Okay, so the first one is we'll start with the arithmetic operators and then comparison and then assignment, logical, unary, identity, bitwise and membership. Okay, so these are all the 8 kinds of operators we'll be looking into this class. Now coming to the arithmetic operators, I have already briefed you about arithmetic operators in the previous classes, and we also have seen certain output for each and every arithmetic operator and the importance of each and every operator we have seen. Okay, so the addition operator will perform addition plus between two variables. Subtraction will do subtraction between two variables, multiplication, division, and modulus will give you the remainder. And exponential will power a number. And flow division will give you the quotient. Okay, so these are all the arithmetic operators we have seen. So let us just put everything together in a single program. So the value of A is equal to 30 and B, and accordingly we have put in the print statement. So I said A plus B is equal to, and then since I have used a concatenation operator here, I have converted the result also into a string. The result is like A plus B, so the result is obtained, 50 is obtained as the result of 30 and 20. And again, I have converted this 50 into string and then concatenated with the string. So the output is obtained like A plus B is equal to 50. And in the other print statements, I have directly calculated the values for different operations. Okay, for subtraction and division and multiplication and modulus and all that. Okay, so I hope everybody is clear, can understand this particular slide. And the next operators are comparison operators. Comparison operators are equal to, not equal to, less than, greater than equal to, and less than equal to. So these operators will return a Boolean value for me. Okay, so we have taken two values over here, A is equal to 10 and B is equal to 20. And A is equal to B, so since 10 is equal to B, so we are trying to check for the equality between the two variables, so it is false. A not equal to B, yes, it is true, okay, because 10 is not equal to 20. And likewise, we have checked for A less than or equal to. Just I want you to actually, the takeaway from this particular slide is like you just have to see the syntax, like how you can give, because everybody know like what will be the outcome of this particular operation, but I want you to go through the syntax because it is different from the syntax that we already have seen in the C programming. Okay, so A is less than or equal to B, okay, so which is true because 10 is less than 20. And A is greater than 10 is greater than B, which is false, and A is greater than B, which is false, and A is less than B, which is okay. So the outcome of these comparison operators will be Boolean value, and these comparison operators are also called as relational operators. And next, coming to the assignment operator. Assignment operator, as I said, like it will be with the single equal to. Now double equal to is equality, okay, so don't get confused with double equal to, because you already are C programmer, so I think you will be knowing this difference. Double equal to is equality check, whereas single equal to is considered to be an assignment operator. So assignment operator over here will be having a left side and the right side. Okay, so this is the left hand side, which we call it as LHS. Okay, so like how we have seen in mathematics, and this is RHS. So what all will be there on the right side will be put in the left hand side variable. Okay, so that is the purpose of the assignment operator. And since I said, like I said, A is equal to 10 and B is equal to 20, and I just printed the values of A and B, and later on I have assigned B to A. Not only giving a literal, you also the essence of this particular program is to make you understand that not only giving a literal to a variable, you can also assign a variable to a variable. Okay, so what happens over here is Since the value of b is equal to 20, 20 will go into 10. Okay, so this is an kind of auto variables that you have seen in C programming, where the variable, the value that the variable holds can keep changing. Okay, so here it kept changing. So when I try to print a and b again, now the value of a has changed to the value of b because I have used this statement prior to the print statement. Okay, so this is assignment operator. And inside the assignment operators, okay, so this is one kind of operations that you also have seen in C programming, and this is also permissible in Java programming as well. We call this as assignment, compound assignment, but here we are calling this as in place operator, but in C and all that, we call this as the compound assignment operator. Okay, anyway, here we'll be calling this as in place operators. Okay, so the in place operator can be used on any data type. And when I say plus equal to, so what is the significance of plus equal to is that it is kind of compound assignment. Rather than writing a big statement like this, where I am saying a is equal to a plus b, I can write it in cut short, wherein I'll say a plus is equal to b. Okay, so the meaning is same. Okay, so when your interpreter sees a plus is equal to b, it understands that it has to do a plus b and put the result back in a variable. Okay, here two things are happening. Okay, so in this particular compound assignment or the in place operator, two things are happening. The first thing is an arithmetic is happening on a plus b, and the second thing is that the result is again put back in a. Okay, so these two things happen in the compound assignment or the in place operators. Okay, so here the meaning of this is add and assign. So plus is equal to means that it is adding and assigning. So two things happen. The first thing is add and the next one is assign. Okay, adds the operand on the left and right side of the operator and assigns the result back to the operand on the left side. This is very important that the assigning back the result to the variable on the left side. In the similar way, like we are having compound subtract over here. So we are saying minus is equal to is subtract and assign. Okay, so whatever is here as an operator, we'll say that and then we'll say assign. Okay, so what is the meaning of this is that A minus is equal to B is same as, is similar as A is equal to A minus B. Okay, so it subtracts the operands on the left and right side of the operator and assigns the results to the operand on the left side. Okay. So this is regarding minus is equal to, and next coming to into is equal to. So this is multiply and assign. Okay, so the meaning of this is a into is equal to b is similar to a is equal to a into b. Okay, so it multiplies the operand on the left and right side of the operator and assigns the results to back to the variable on the left side. So it assigns the result back to the variable over here, which is a, which is on the left side of the operator, which is equal to. And next is divide and assign. So you'll be using it something like this. So divide and assign, so which is similar to this. So I can say, I can write it in either ways. It doesn't mean that you just have to write A divided is equal to B. You can also use this kind of format, but which is faster. So whenever we look into the programming, like we just adopt to the conventions which actually make our program work much faster. So rather than this particular convention, this convention of writing in the program actually makes your code run much faster. So that's the reason why you're having this in place, because it has got the meaning inside. So you also are avoiding one step over here, like you are not using this A again and again in the program. So what happens is this kind of convention is fast in execution. So that's why we generally adopt to do this. But even if you write it in this way, it doesn't matter, okay? But anyway, having difference of point, some seconds or microseconds, difference will not be significant. So when you feel that, you can simply use this, okay? Right. So divide the operand on the left and right side of the operator and assign the result to the operand on the left side. Okay, so that's what will happen if you are using that. And this is modulus send assign. So again, similar way, like A mod is equal to B will be much faster than A is equal to A mod B. So you can give it in this way to make your code work much faster in case if you're having it in your code. And this divide the operand on the left and right side of the operators and assign the remainder. Okay, so this is a very handy operator which is used in a lot of arithmetics, lot of programs. Okay, so the modulus will actually give you the remainder. And next is floor division and assign. So double slash over here represents floor division and assign. So this is a shortcut how you will be giving this compound assignment of floor division. So I say A floor division is equal to B, same as A is equal to A floor division B. Okay, you know, like it gives the quotient. Okay, and the result is given to the left side of the variable. If one of the operands is negative, the result is float and assigned to the operand on the left. Okay, so the result is float. Okay, so what is meant by flooring is like it goes to the nearest lowest number. Okay, so that is floor. And seal is like it goes to the highest number. Okay, sealing and flooring we call that as. Okay, flooring is like it goes to the negative, the lowest number. Seal is like it goes to the nearest highest number. And next is exponent and assign. So exponent and assign, you know, like the symbol is double star asterisk over here. So A double asterisk is equal to B is same as A is equal to A double asterisk B. Okay. And so which performs the exponential calculations. Okay. So which means that A power B or A rise to B and all that. And assigns the results back to A. Okay, so these are all the in-place operators, and here I have shown you the results practically. Okay, so this is A is equal to 10 and B is equal to 20. So I said A plus is equal to B, so which is similar to A plus B, that is equal to 30. Okay, so in the similar way, like we are having the subtraction over here, 10 minus 20, which will give me a minus 10. Okay, and so why we are adopting to such kind of convention is that it becomes much faster. And A is equal to 10 and B is equal to 20 and A is equal to A into B, so which is 200. And then A is equal to 10 and B is equal to 20, A divided by B, okay, so which is 0.5. And so then here we are using the modulus, so 20 modulus 3, which will give me 2, okay. So and herein we are saying 1 mod 5, which will give me the first operand, so which is 1 itself, okay. So right. So this is modulus operation. And next is floor division. So wherein I'm saying 20 divided by 3, the quotient will be 6. So I got 6 as an answer. And here I said minus 5 and 4. Okay, so when I divide minus 5 and 4, the quotient that I'll be getting is 1.2, I suppose. Okay, so I'll be getting 1.2. So as I said, like if it is negative number, so if you remembered, I said like it will be floored. Okay, so it will be floored. What is the nearest nearest number? Okay, so to minus 1.2 is minus 2. Okay, so that is the nearest lesser number. So minus 2. Okay, so that's why it is giving me a minus 2 over here. Okay, so that's the flooring one. Okay, so and then coming to the next one. So the next one is an exponential, which is 20 power 3. So which is which will give me 8000 as an answer. So just trying to get into this kind of convention of writing. Okay, fine. So how this in-place operators will work on strings? Yes, this of course will work on strings. So herein I said S1 is equal to Sri Vishnu and I said S2 is equal to college for women. And so I'm saying S1 plus is equal to S2, which means that S1 is equal to S1 plus S2. Don't forget the immutable thing, like it will not make changes to Sri Vishnu. It will create a new object, which is Sri Vishnu College for Women. And then it will reassign this S1 to this particular string. Sri Vishnu will still be there in your string pool. Okay, right. And College for Women also will be there still in your string pool. The only thing is you should not forget the concept of immutable. Strings are immutable. So there won't be any change that is done to Sri Vishnu. but new string will be created, which is Sri Vishnu College for Women, and then S7 will be assigned to this particular string. Okay, so understanding this string immutable concept is very important. And here I said, here the thing is, like, I can say S1 plus is equal to S2. This is totally valid syntax. And so we are, you're printing, you're creating a new string, Sri Vishnu College for Women, and assigning it to the object S1. So S1 is the reference variable which is pointing to this object. Sri Vishnu College for Women is the object over here. Okay, so which is the object over here, and this S1 that we are talking about is the reference variable. Okay, so the reference variable is the variable that will be pointing to the object. So S1 will be assigned. So this is like your pointer. Okay, so which will be pointing to a particular value, and the value here is the object, and this is your reference variable. S1 is the reference variable. So of course you can use this particular compound assignment or the in place operator on the strings also. And the next operator is the unary operator. Okay, so unary acts on a single operand. Okay, so you're saying, I said b is equal to 10, and then I'm saying a is equal to minus of b. So this particular 10 will be converted into, because I have put a minus over here, so this 10 will be converted into minus 10. So, and very important point over here is, like, Python does not support prefix, postfix, increment and decrement operators, right? And the next important operators are the bitwise operators. Bitwise operators perform operations at the bit level. Okay, so we'll be performing it at the bit level. And bitwise operators cannot be applied. So it is cannot. Okay, so they cannot be applied on floats and double variables. And the bitwise operators are bitwise AND, OR, and XOR, and the shift operators. Okay, so there are two kinds of shift operators we'll be seeing. One is the right shift. Okay, so one is the right shift and the other one is the left shift operator. So these two operators will be seen. And I think these two operators, these operators you also have seen in C programming. When we, in my lectures, I generally compare these programming languages like C, Java and Python, because I know all the three programming languages, and it is very important for you to learn the differences between the three programming languages, because these three are asked for your interviews. Okay, so they're considered, the programming languages are very important for your interviews, and they'll ask you for the comparison between the programming languages. Anyway, I also wanted to give you the difference between including C++ also, but not to confuse you, so I'm not giving you with C++. There is another operator, shift operator in Java, which is called as right shift zero fills. Three operators are there. One special shift operator is there in Java, which is not there in Python. Okay, so in Python, you can just get adopted to all that you have seen in C programming. Okay, so since I said, like, they are bit level operations, so I said, like, I have a variable A with 10 value. This 10 is the decimal value. When I convert it into the binary value, it will be 1010. So there are, here I'm showing only 4 bits over here for you. But it depends whether it is taking, considering 8 bits or 16 bits or whatever. So that also, the other bits are also there. But since we can just show it like this, I'm showing it like this. Okay, so this is 8, and this is 4, so this is 2, and this is 1, right? So which is 2 power 0, 2 power 1, 2 power 2, and 2 power 3. Okay, right. And so this is again 7. So if you want to perform bitwise AND operation, okay, so bitwise AND operation, so what happens is you just need to look into the truth table. So 1 and 0 will give me a 0. 1 and 0 will give me a 0, and 1 and 1 will give me a 1. 0 and 1 will give me a 0, and 1 and 0 will give me a 0. Okay, so when I convert this binary number into decimal, the answer will be 2. Okay, so A, 10 and 7 will result in 2. Okay, so this is how the bitwise AND operation is performed. Okay, so let me show you another programming example, how you can put it in the program and all that. You can directly give the decimal values also, but I just try to give in binary. So whenever you are giving a binary literal, we should give 0 and b. This b can be uppercase b or lowercase b, any of this you can give. Okay, so whenever your interpreter sees the a 0 and a b, it understands that it is a binary literal. Okay, so I just have given a binary literal over here, and this is the truth table of the AND operation. These are the bit combinations for A and B. So the bit combinations of A and B are like 0 0 0 1 1 0 and 1 1. If A is 0 and B is 0, then when the AND will result in a 0. And this you can apply for true and false also. Like if it is false and false, it is false. And any one is false, then obviously the output is false for AND operation. Both need to be true to get a true. Okay, so this is the truth table for logical bitwise AND. And so herein I have taken the values of B and A. This is the bit levels over here, and so I have taken B like this. Okay, so the value of B is 10, and then we have taken another value which is A is 13. Okay, so and then when you perform some operation between these two, so you can see that 0 and 1, so okay, 0 and 1, okay, is giving a 0 over here, so it is 0. And then 0 and 1 and 0 again is giving a 0. 1 and 0 and 1 is giving a 0. And 1 and 1 is giving a 1 over here. Okay, so then this binary value, which is 1000, is converted into decimal, and the answer is 8 over here. So this is how the answer is given for you when you put it in a program. Okay, so herein I have, rather than giving a binary literal, I have given an decimal literal. Okay, so internally this 45 will be converted into binary, and this 11 will be converted into binary. And then the AND operation, like how I have shown you, the AND operation will be performed and the result will be given. So the result of 45 and 11 will be 9. Okay, so 45 and 11 will be equal to 9. And next is coming to the OR operation. Okay, so this OR operation is also performed on the bit wise, okay, on the bit level. And the truth table for the OR operation is that if both are zeros, then it results in a 0. Else, if any one of the bit is 1, then the result will be 1. Okay, so that's the truth table. And herein again, we have taken the values of A and B. Okay, so then performed OR operation. And the symbol, like you just need to see the symbol of OR, which will be above your enter key. Okay, so this OR symbol will be there above your enter key, and which is also called as pipeline operator. Okay, so you can see this there, which is actually used, which is also called as pipeline. Okay, so pipeline operator and antamo. So this you can find it above your enter key, and you have to use that in your program. Okay, so I have herein I have taken the binary literals, and so the result of this is 15. So you can see 0 and 1 is giving me a 1 according to the truth table. You just need to compare and keep the truth table in mind to produce the result. And 1 and 0 again, because there is a 1 there, I'll get a 1. If 1 is there, I'll get 1 in the result. So 8 plus 4 plus 2 plus 1, which is equal to 15. Okay, fine. So this is the OR operation. And next coming to XOR operation. So XOR operation is given with the cap symbol. So this is the cap symbol, which you can find in on the key 6. Okay, so on the keyboard, in the keyboard, like it is there with the 6 number. Okay, so this is what is called as cap symbol, which is used for XOR operator. And so the truth table for the XOR operator is something like this. If it's 0 and 0 and 1 and 1, the result will be zeros. Other than that, the combination, the results will be 1 and 1. Okay, and so we have taken A and B over here. So if any one of the operators is any one of the bit is 1, okay, so I got a 1. And 1 and 0, again I got a 1. And 0 and 1, again I got a 1. But 1 and 1 will result in a 0. So here it is 4 plus 2 plus 1. Okay. So 4 plus 2 plus 1. This is 0. The 8 is 0. So we will not consider this value. So 4 plus 2 plus 1, which is equal to 7. Okay. So the result is 7. And you can observe that you are getting the result only in decimal, but if you want the result to be obtained even in binary format, then you need to typecast it. I'll tell you in the later classes how to actually typecast your result. Okay, so here because you're taking the input in the as a binary literal, but you're getting the output as a decimal. If you want to get it in the binary, you can get it. Okay, so for that you need to typecast it. I will see that in the later classes. And the next one is like a bitwise NOT operator. So NOT means like it is complement. Okay, 1 becomes 0 and 0 becomes 1. That's the only strategy over here. And we'll be using this symbol, which is also called as tilde symbol. Okay, so which is used for negation. Okay, so you can use this in your programs. Okay, so when I negate it, what happens is I'll be getting this. Now you might wonder like why did I get minus 11? I'll tell you how we got minus 11. So there is a formula also, but anyway, okay. So when herein we are considering 8 bits, okay. So not 4 bits, 8 bits. So the complement of, so what happened over here is we have taken 10, right? So we are having 4 zeros and then this is 8. 0 1 0. Okay, so this is what is 10. I think we have taken 10 over here. Okay, so we have taken the binary 10 over here. And once when you do this negation of this, all the zeros will become 1 and 1s will become 0. So it will be 0 and then 1 and 0, and these zeros also will become 1s. Okay, so when these zeros will become 1, the value of this is minus 11. Okay, so generally negative numbers are actually stored as 2's complement inside your computer. Okay, so negative numbers are stored as 2's complement. 2's complement is nothing but the 1's complement plus adding 1 to it, which is called as 2's complement. Okay, so for example, to represent 11, I'm just telling you some technical points over here. So how minus 11 is stored inside your computer. So minus 11 is negative number, right? There is a minus over here. So first thing what it will do is it will take 11 and it will perform the 1's complement of it. So this is 11, right? 8 plus 2 plus 1, okay? So which is equal to 11. So this will be, it will perform the 1's complement of it, and so the bits will be reversed. 1's complement is nothing but reversing of the bits. So 1 will become 0 and 0 will become 1 and all that. And after doing that, 1 will be added to the 1's complement. So 1 will be added. So once I add this 1 to this particular 1's complement, I'll get this answer. So this is nothing but minus 11. Okay, so minus 11 is represented like this inside your computer. Okay, wherein this most significant bit, so there are two kinds of bits in any of the bit format. So the left hand side over here, which is called as most significant bit, it depends on whether it is considering 8 bits or it depends on whether it is considering 16 bits or whether it is considering 32 bits. Okay. And this right side bit, okay, so this bit is called as the least significant bit. Anyway, this most significant bit is the sign decision bit, okay. So if there is a 1, it means that it is a negative number. If there is a 0 in the most significant bit, it means that it is a positive number. So herein I said, right, we are taking a 11. So 11 is positive number. So that's why this most significant bit is having a 0. So here it is the most significant bit is because we are representing minus 11. So the most significant bit will decide whether it is zero or whether it is positive or negative. Okay, so when you perform this NOT operation on this 10, I'm getting 10 will change to minus 11. So this formula you can apply to all the things. Okay, so if you are converting 11, then you'll get minus 12 and all that. Okay, so this is a formula to understand. Okay, so this is it with the AND, OR, and XOR and NOT operations that are performed on the bits. And not only this, we'll be seeing how the shift operations are performed. Okay, so the shift operations means that you'll be shifting the bits onto the left side and the right side of in their positions. So Python supports two shift operators. They are left shift and right shift operators, and they're given with this symbol. The left shift operator is given with a symbol, two less than symbols over here, and the right shift is given with two right greater than symbols. And what you can easily remember this because it's pointing something like this, right? So when you see this, it is pointing this side onto the right side. So this is the right shift operators, because I see many of the students getting confused with the left shift and right shift operator. Just follow this point. Okay, so this pointing, this greater than symbol has got this point which is pointing onto the right side. So it means right shift operator. Okay, now this is the general form or the syntax of the shift operation. So how do you give it in programming? Okay, so in programming you say operand, and then you say operator, and then the number of shifts to the places. Okay, so this operand is a variable, and this OP can be the left shift or the right shift operator, and this number indicates how many places you want to shift. You want to shift two places or one place or two places or three places. All that is decided by this number. Okay, right. Now we'll see the examples. Coming to the left shift operator. Okay, so you always have to remember this. Okay, so what happened over here is 1, 2, 4, 8. So the pattern is that, so 1 into 2 is 2, 2 into 2 is 4, 4 into 2 is 8, 8 into 2 is 16, 16 into 2 is 32. So you can see that there is a multiplication that is happening over here. Okay, so whenever you do a left shift, there will be a multiplication. The number will be doubled. Okay, so whenever you shift 1 onto the left side, the number will be doubled. Okay, so just trying to understand this. And here I have given a binary literal. Okay, so this is a binary literal which is representing 29. Okay, as I said, 29 into 2. Okay, so I just shifted one place. Okay, so when I just shifted one place, 29 into 2. Okay, so 29 into 2 will give you a 58. So I got an answer which is 58. And as you can see, why I have given this particular zero over here is that, so when the bits are moved like this, what happens is the bit over here, okay, so this has gone out of scope. Okay, so this zero that we have here has moved out of scope. Okay, so that is gone. It is lost. Okay, so you can observe that this bit is lost. Okay, so whenever you shift onto the left, what happens is the most significant bit is lost. So this bit is lost. And you have to add a value into the this particular position, which is LSB, into the least significant bit position. You have to add something because there is nothing over here to add. And so what you will be adding is a zero. You will be adding a zero, and this bit will be lost. Okay, right. And so as I said, like 29 will be doubled whenever you do a left shift. Any number that you take will be doubled. So if I'm taking 4 and I'm doing 4 left shift 1, what will happen is it will become 8. Okay, so just try to remember that. So this is left shift operation. And okay, so this is, I have taken a negative number, which is minus 11. So I already have shown you minus 11, how it is represented. It is a 2's complement of the number is represented as a negative number. So minus 11 is put like this, and when you left shift it, okay, so you'll be getting 490 as an answer. Okay, so this is how you have got, and I am showing you all practically how the shift is happening with this particular diagram. And I'm adding a zero onto this particular position because there is no bit to be added. I'll be adding a zero. Okay, so this is regarding left shifting of a negative number. Now coming to the right shift operation. Okay, so this is the right shift operation. I have taken the example 29 again. Okay, so you can observe that from this side, if you just see 16, when I move on to the right side, okay, so when I move on to the right side, what is happening is 16 divided by 2 has happened. Okay, so 16 divided by 2, which is 8, 8 divided by 2, which is 4, 4 divided by 2, which is 2, and 2 divided by 2, which is 1. Okay, so what is happening with the right shift is, so you're having this division operation that is happening whenever you're moving on to the right side. Okay, so for example, so this 29 divided by 2, which will give me a 14. Okay, so this is what I got over here. Some values will be lost. So as I said, like this bit over here is lost. Okay, so this bit is lost. And we are just adding zero here on the most significant position. Okay, so this is what will happen when you're doing a right shift. Okay, so here I have taken an other operation wherein I have shifted it three times. Okay, so I have shifted it three times. So when you see this is the first shift, this is the second shift, and this is the third shift I have done. And finally, you got this answer, which is 3. Okay, fine. So 29 divided by 2, 14 divided by 2, and 7 divided by 2. Okay, so wherein I'm getting 3 over here. So whenever you move the numbers onto the right side, it will be dividing it. Okay, right. And so here I have taken a negative number. So I have taken minus 11. So you can see that the number is lost. Okay, so this one is lost. Okay, and we are adding a zero here. And so I'm getting 122 as the answer. So when I do a right shift. Okay, by one position. So see, girls, like, it doesn't mean that you just have to do one position. Why I have taken, I have shown you how it happens. Okay, so this number over here can be anything. It can be one, or it can be two, or it can be any integer it can be. Okay, so you can shift anything. Okay, so that's why we are saying it's n. So it can be anything. Okay, so one shift or two shifts. But remember, whenever you're doing a left shift, it is multiplied, and whenever you're doing a right shift, what is happening is you're dividing the number by two. Okay, so that is regarding the left shift and the right shift operations. And the next operators are logical operators. There are three logical operators that Python supports, and the first one is logical and or and not. So you can see that there are two ands over here. Okay, so bitwise and, you're just having a single and. So don't get confused between single and double and. Double and is considered to be the logical operator. And as you can see, I said like these logical expressions are evaluated from left to right. So they're evaluated from left to right. So I can have many conditions over here. So I can have condition one, and then I can have a logical and then condition two. Okay, so I can have a condition two, and then I can have a logical and then I can have a condition three, and like so on. And the operations are evaluated from left to right. And as I said, they're also called as shortcut or lazy operators. And in Java, we call them as short circuit operators. In Python, we are calling them as lazy operators. Just the terminology name is differing, but the concept is same. Okay, and we also call it as short circuit operator, shortcut operators, or whatever. Why do we call it as short circuit and the lazy operators? It's like, you know, in C programming, you already have seen this. Now coming to the logical and, okay, so let me explain you why it is called as the lazy operators. Okay, say for example, I am having two expressions, two conditions over here in this particular expression. This is the entire expression, and I am having two conditions over here. This is condition one, and this is condition two. Okay, so as I said, like A is greater than B is the condition one, and B is greater than C is condition two, wherein this logic is where I am trying to put the three numbers in. I'm trying to find out the great order of the three numbers. Okay, anyway, the logic is incomplete, but still it's a part of it. Now coming to the first condition. So since there is a connection over here, which is logical operator, which is an AND operation. So according to the logical AND truth table, what happens is if any of the condition is false, then the entire expression will be evaluated to be false. Okay, so I'll just show you the truth table. So this is the truth table. So say the expression is false. Okay, so any one of the expressions, any one expression is false, then what happened is the result, the entire result is false. Okay, so now we can make use of this point over here to actually do the lazy thing. Okay, so if the first condition is evaluating to be false, there is no point in evaluating the second condition, because for sure you know that according to the AND logic, you know that the result will be having false. So by looking into this particular condition, say that A is greater than B is evaluating to be false. Okay, so when A is greater than B has evaluated to be false, there is no point in checking this condition, because you for sure know that the entire expression will be false. Even if this B is greater than C is true, okay, so even if this is true or false, it is irrelevant, because if first expression is false, you know for sure that the entire expression will be false. So what we have done here is the second expression will not evaluate at all. So that's why we call this as lazy or short circuit expressions. Okay, so these operators are called as short circuit operators. I hope everybody understood this.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so that is regarding the logical AND, and this is regarding logical OR. Okay, so you're having some condition over here. So why we are calling this as short circuit is that according to the logical OR truth table, okay, so if expression is true, then you for sure know that the expression, the whole expression is true. If one condition is true, you know that the whole expression is true. Okay, so making use of this concept, what we can do is, in case if the first expression, say, is greater than B is evaluating to be true, then what we can do is, you no need to evaluate this particular expression, because this expression, even if it is true or false, so even if it is true or false, it is not a matter for you, because if one expression is one condition is true, you know the entire expression will be evaluated to be true. Okay, so these logical operators are called as lazy operators, just because sometimes only one expression is evaluated, not all the cases, but if one expression is true, then the second expression is not evaluated. The second expression is evaluated only in the case where the first expression becomes false in the OR condition. Okay, so in the OR condition. In the AND condition, if the first expression evaluates to true, then only it goes to the second expression to check whether the second condition is true or false. Else it will not check. If the first condition is false, in the AND case, it will not check the second one. Only if the first expression, first condition is true, it goes and checks for the second condition in AND. In OR, if the first condition is false, then it goes and checks for the second condition. Else, if it is true, it will bypass. Okay, so it will bypass the second condition. Okay, so this is the logical OR operator, and this is the truth table, and this is